Around in May 2023, Next.js witnessed some big changes with the introduction of the new app router. Just prior to that, I had created a video series showing how to build a headless blog with Next.js as the frontend and WordPress as the backend API. It was based on the previous page's router. Many people started asking how to make the project work with the new app router. So I rebuilt the entire project using the app router. If you want to check that out, you can find the code in my GitHub repository. And in this video, we will discuss the important things to keep in mind while making the transition for any existing or new Next.js project. The first thing I want to tell you is that the old pages router is still working. Next.js hasn't yet removed support for it in the latest versions. You can still find documentation for the pages router on the Next.js website. You can continue developing in the old way as if nothing has happened. If you have apps in production that uses the page router, no need to switch in a hurry. However, it looks like the app router is the way forward. So they might remove support for the pages router in the future. I don't know about that. Also, pages and app directories can coexist within the same project. Some pages can be within the old pages directory while some can be within the app directory. So you can move pages incrementally. However, the same page cannot be inside both the pages and the app directories simultaneously. The next major change is regarding how you name the routes. The pages router followed a file and folder based routing system. For instance, if you have a route location like members/list, then you define it inside pages members list.js. That has changed with the new app router. All routes are identified with the name of the folder in which it exists. So the same example becomes app/members/list/page.js. Note that list is a folder which identifies the route path within which we define the file page.js or ts. Here page.js is a reserved file name in the Next.js app router, which is used to export the page component for any route. For instance, if you have another route like blog/mypost, you can define it as app/blog/dynamic/page.js. In effect, you end up having a page.js file inside each route folder. So if your app has 10 routes, then you will have 10 page.js files nested within the app directory. And that's also one thing I don't quite like with the new approach. Having multiple files with identical file names, the app directory can look quite a mess if your app has a few dozen routes. The problem exacerbates when considering that page.js is not the only reserved file name. You can also have nested layout.js files, route.js files, etc. for defining API routes and so on. Third point, the app.js and document.js files are gone. With pages, you can use app.js and document.js files to define custom app and document structures. Moving to the app router, both of them are replaced by the layout files. As I already mentioned, layout is another reserved file name. Layouts can be placed alongside page.js files inside the route folders. You can also have multiple levels of nested layouts, which means there can be a parent layout file in the root directory with sub-layouts inside route folders. Want to import global style sheets? You can do that within the root layout file. Also, layout takes the inner layouts and pages as its children. So the root layout file, that is app/layout.js, is mandatory. I think this move has simplified the layout arrangement when compared to the previous __app and __document files based arrangement. Another major change is with regards to how you fetch external data within pages and API routes. In the pages router, there were two functions, getStaticProps and getServerSideProps. Both functions run on the server side during build time or during server side rendering, depending on whether you are using static site generation or server side rendering respectively. And within these functions, you could perform fetch requests and return the results. and these returned values would be available to the default export function as props. Now both these functions are completely gone in the app router. Instead, you can directly use the JavaScript fetch API that most of us are already used to. No need to put them inside special functions like getStaticProps or getServerSideProps. Since all the components are server components by default in the app router, more on that later, you can rest assured that the fetch operation happens on the server and not on the client. The next point is about static site generation. In the pages router, when you want to statically generate dynamic routes, you could return an array of route paths values from the getStaticPaths function. Now this function name has changed to generate static params. Apart from the name change, the structure of the returned object has also simplified. No need for the fallback property either. The next point is about how you handle SEO data. In my opinion, SEO was a bit of a mess in the pages router. You had to fetch and return all the SEO tags inside the getStaticProps or getServerSideProps function, then insert it inside the head component appropriately. Instead of that, app router has built-in support for SEO. You can export a constant object called metadata, which contains the title, description, open graph, tags, and so on. Or if you want to generate these values dynamically, define a function called generateMetadata, which then fetches all the values and returns the object. Next.js will automatically insert these metadata values within the head tag during build time or render time. Next, let's see how to create API routes with the new app router. In the pages router, all API routes were defined within the API folder. And each API route file exported a function named handler with two arguments, request and response. Now there aren't any restrictions like that. You can create API routes in any folder, not just the API folder. Make sure to name the API route file as route.js. That's how they differ from other page routes. Here, note that the route.js file name is another reserved file name. The handler function has also changed. Now you can denote the request method by the name of the function like get, post, put, delete, etc. Within the route handler functions, you can use the next request and next response objects, which are extended from the native request and response objects available with the JavaScript fetch API. Overall, the API feature has become more powerful with the new app router. Now let's visit the revalidation and caching behavior. In the pages router, you could set the revalidate property inside the getStaticProps function to tell Next.js how often to fetch the latest data from the source. Else, if you wanted to fetch the data on every request, getServerSideProps should be used instead of getStaticProps. There was also a fallback property alongside revalidate that dictates when to run the getStaticProps function. Now all these confusions are gone. All data fetches are cached by default when used with the fetch function. The cache persists infinitely if no other options are used. If you want to completely opt out of cache, add the option cache no store to the fetch function call. This makes it equivalent to using the getServerSideProps function. Fresh data is fetched on every request. Data can also be refetched periodically. For that, add the revalidate option. For instance, revalidate 3600 fetches fresh data at most every 1 hour. The next major change is regarding the new React Server Components feature. It has been the talk of the town for a while. At first, I could not wrap my head around this concept. Next.js already renders React components on the server, right? Then how does it make sense? That was my initial thought. Anyways, here is what I have understood so far. The concept is still a bit confusing to me. So, in the pages router, all components are client components. You cannot create server components. Whereas in the app router, all components are server components by default. However, you can create client components by adding the use client directive at the top of the file. But don't get confused by the term client component. A client component gets rendered on the server and on the client, or in other words, hydrated on the client. With hydration, the components are sent to the client and made interactive. So you can use effects, state data, and other interactive things. Whereas a server component is rendered on the server only. It's neither sent to the client nor hydrated. Hence, it will be non-interactive. State, use effect, etc. will not work. The advantages are lesser bundle size. Also, data fetching and processing happens entirely on the server. That's the difference. Let's take an example. Consider there is a component like this in the app router. This button's onClick function will not trigger because it is inside a server component. So how to make it interactive? That's where you can use a client component. But how to create a client component? So when you want interactivity, move that part to a child component, then switch to the client mode by adding the use client directive at the top. Make sure to add the directive at the top of the file. The use client directive marks all the components in that file as client components. Also, if you import other components into a client component, they will also function as client components. In effect, the use client directive works like a boundary between server components at the top level and client components below that. Okay, now import the new client component inside the parent server component. Now this button's onClick event handler function will work. However, the opposite is not possible. I mean, you cannot import a server component into a client component. Some features like the SEO metadata function we discussed earlier can only be used inside a server component. Also, data fetching should also be performed inside server components because it is often closer to the data source. I am still learning about the new features in Next.js, so if there is anything incorrect in what I have presented, kindly point out. Hope this video was helpful. Thanks for watching.